Greetings, this is Danny Filth for Cradle of Filth, and you're getting your fix of Metal Injection.
What's up, guys? Frank here with the one, the only Danny Filth. You have such a way with words and telling a story. I mean, the sheer amount of lyrics and the iambic pentameter in what you do, it's really impressive. I know singers who can barely memorize half of what you write.
I didn't say I can memorize it.
Well, I was going to ask, what's your
write it,
your trick to memorizing all this music that you have to do every night?
Well, the trick is, if you get to a tricky part, you just go, get the audience to sing it. Well, I mean, come on, there's only like, we play like 15, 16 songs. If you can't memorize that, then there's always like a couple of little stickler points, you know, that every gig you go, why the did I forget that bit again? But no, I should be able to remember that.
How did you know that was your writing style in the beginning? I mean, you know, like the long-winded passages and storytelling.
I guess it just comes from a literal background, quite literally. From schooling and interest in Gothic literature, and I suppose being English to the hilt. It's when we started out, you know, keyboards and orchestration and cinematic aspect of metal was in its burgeoning sort of stages. It was very natal.
Right.
And it's nowadays, obviously, it's two a penny, but back then it was kind of frowned upon. People sneered at, ooh, you got keyboards in, you know, that's not metal.
Of course.
But it fitted the whole soundtrack quality.
Yeah, I think it fits really well. And on that same token, I mean, you've been shredding your vocals for over two decades now, yet you sound just as good, if not better, than when you started. What is the secret behind, you know, keeping your voice intact?
not to do too many interviews, because after a while you learn how to look after it. This tour, I'm not drinking whatsoever. And I don't actually think, apart from, you know, the odd hangover, which I hate more than anything, I don't think it's actually improved the vocals as such. I always used to find that hangover days, that my voice would sound really good for some reason. So I don't know, you know, it's a long-winded path to, I think, when you learn the secret about life, not just, you know, how to look after your voice, but I think it's always going to happen on your deathbed.
Right.
It's that ironic, right, you know, last minute where you just go, oh, I just realize, and then collapse and die.
So until then, you're still trying to figure it out, right?
Kind of, yeah. You're sort of bouncing from pillar to post.
And of course, I wanted to talk about your merch, because there isn't a festival or a show around the world that I go to that I still don't see a Cradle of Filth shirt somewhere. I wanted to know, how much attention or creative input do you put into your merchandising and videos, really?
Well, a lot. Obviously not bootlegs, because they're done without, you know, your permission. But yeah, I mean, everything is always goes through me and the band. And we do spend a lot of time, you know. I mean, back in the early days, some of our designs would get moaned at by the merchandise company, because to set up the shoots, we'd do a shoot with these models and, you know, like scenarios that you had this idea for a slogan and a look, so you'd set it all up. And I remember we were actually losing money on a couple of shirts, because the setup cost. We did it in London, a big famous photography studio with famous models and blah blah blah, and it was like 5,000, you know, I mean, it was ridiculous. Mm. And they're saying like, okay, this is 6 months and this is your bi-monthly bill, and you're actually losing money on a couple of these designs.
You could tell us the story about the Jesus of the Cunt shirt, because that is just,
oh, well,
still
I was purposely trying not to swear and you just came out with it.
Oh, well, fuck, shit, cunt, oh, whatever.
Yeah. Cunt, shitty, bollock, fuck, wank.
But yeah, the story of that, I mean, I always wanted to know, simply just, it's probably the most notorious shirt in all of heavy metal history.
The origins of it are quite humble, really. We were sitting on the lawn of, it was actually, just prior to our first tour, whereas Emperor and Cradle of Filth tour in England, we did like four shows. I say England, it was Great Britain, because we did one in Edinburgh in Scotland, which was a total disaster. And if you told people this now, they go, no way, Emperor and Cradle of Filth, we pulled three people, which is less than, you know, that's half the amount of people that were on stage. But anyway, yeah, it was prior to that tour, and we were sitting on the lawn of our record company guys at Mum's house, funny enough, and we were just messing around with the title, and then it just popped out, and everybody was in hysterics about it, saying we couldn't put that on the shirt, and they're like, fuck it, we're going to put it on the shirt. And originally, it wasn't a satanic statement, it was more overtly anarchic, really, you know, by taking a notorious figure and just saying, you know, fuck him. And that was what the humour was about. We thought it was humorous, but obviously it's taken quite a sinister slant over the years. It did make me laugh a couple of years ago with the woman that was arrested in New Zealand.
Right.
Because her whole point of defacing the glass in which the T-shirt was imprisoned was so that nobody else could see it, so it wouldn't bring any more attention to it. And yet it brought worldwide attention to it because it was in every major newspaper. So it kind of backfired on her.
Yeah, still stirring shit after all this time. You know?
Yeah. Like,
going back in your place in black metal history, Norway gets a lot of attention for it, and rightfully so. But I think people don't say this enough, that your band and Emperor really opened the door for and changed the game in the black metal scene. You know,
like, yeah, but that's a sore point with some people anyway. I mean, it's if you, like, for example, you take this new Lords of Chaos film, you get a lot of people, and they come from both sides of the tracks, from the black metal, that side of the black metal fence, and then just regular Joes who, you know, they want to see a Hollywood movie, so they don't care, you know, if Euronymous takes a shit here, or, you know, Varg, that he's not quite skinny enough, or he's not such a ponce as he was in real life, or whatever. You know, people are divided about it, and the same about Cradle. You had, like, the people that liked the idea that it was bringing it to a bigger audience, and an audience that were, you know, enabling other bands to rush the gate, and, you know, then you'd be able to buy the albums in shops, be able to ever see your bands live. And then there was the underground people who thought that we'd, you know, betrayed the Magician's Guild because now, you know, the guy next door could pick up an album, and you shouldn't be able to do that. You'd have to summon a Mayhem album by the light of the full moon. I mean, I remember buying the first, I still have Death Crush at home, and it's pink. It's not red, like, it's pink.
Right.
And at the time, it was just widely regarded by everybody in the scene, everybody, as just a very, very poor thrash metal album. Not a black metal album, a poor thrash metal album.
Right.
So, it depends what side of the fence you're actually sitting on. I mean, obviously, I think it's great that we got big.
Going back then, what was the aim for what you wanted to do with Cradle of Filth, and how did you feel that you fit into the black metal realm?
Well, we were always singular anyway, because we were divided from mainland Europe by the tractor war to the North Sea and whatever. And yeah, we did get, for a long time, even by English publications like Metal Hammer and Terrorizer and Overkill and what's it called, Overkill? Oh, I can't remember, whatever. And Kerrang just totally dismissed and went straight for the Norwegian stuff because it was selling publications, because it was, you know, there in your face, church burning, murder, etc., arson. So we were kind of dismissed for a while, and then when they realised they couldn't ignore us, they started picking up on us. But originally, yeah, I mean, anybody that starts a band, they don't imagine in their head, when they have a vision of how they want the band to be, they don't picture themselves playing in front of two people and a dog, as we did pretty much in Glasgow, sorry, in Edinburgh with Emperor that time. They picture themselves, obviously, on a big stage. I always picture myself like Tom Araya, big stage, you know, like sea of fans. And we got to that level. I mean, I won't deny that wasn't the aim. It doesn't mean that is what was going to happen.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? When I picture myself driving a nice car, I picture myself in a Lamborghini, not like a battered old rusted Fiat.
Right.
We had our ideas and we stuck to them through thick and thin, and here we are now. God knows how many years on, 25 years on.
Yeah, since Principles, yeah. That said, what's your feelings on where black metal stands today? I mean, with like shoegaze and, you know, post-rock and everything entering the scene.
Well, I thought it was called black gaze now, and I thought, oh, That sounds like a very dodgy magazine. I don't know. I mean, I must admit, I do follow the scene, but I find it very fragmented. But maybe that's a good thing because there's so much original stuff out there. Personally, my favorite bands at the moment, even edging towards that sort of thing, just off the top of my head, not the classic bands, obviously, you know, that, I've got too many to mention, but I really, at the moment, really into Alcest, Kraft, their White Noise and Black Metal album was like one of my highlights last year. Love it.
Amazing record.
And I'm really into Zeal and Ardor as well, because I really like what they do. I just find it really more sinister than a lot of black metal stuff. It's deeply sinister, I find. Especially the first EP. Just incredible. But yeah, I find the scene a little fragmented, obviously because it's not big and bold and brash as it was, and it's not selling controversy as much. Maybe it is going to a little bit more, but that's going to be the mainstream that's going to buy into that because of the Lords of Chaos film.
Right.
Maybe that's why people are so upset about it. Oh, it's being shown to the mainstream. It's not being shown properly. Well, get over it, love. You know, I mean, it's a bloody Hollywood movie. You know, when you make a film, you don't show people having a shit or eating their breakfast. You might do. I don't know.
What was your personal feelings on that movie?
I really liked it. Yeah. I really did like it. I used to be a pen pal, Euronymous, and so I only saw, you know, the side he wanted me to see. Yeah, and he was kind of a strange guy, but he also was quite funny as well. He used to like make little jokes in his letters to us. He had no care about whether we were an English band or not. He really dug Cradle of Filth, which, you know, I suppose to the majority of people is a bit weird. Burzum's record label relocated to my tiny village in England. The woman Diamandis actually interviewed me for Kerrang! Magazine and fell in love with the village in which I lived because it's very like kind of mystical, I suppose. And so she relocated and lived on the edge of the famous graveyard there and brought her record label with her. And much of all the photos you used to have of like people wearing the really dodgy Burzum shirts were all shot around where I lived. Around my house, in fact. I think, from what I know of the people, and I remember Bard Faust telling me, confiding in me, completely drunk, that he'd murdered someone, and me just going, yeah, whatever. And then he fell asleep, and we covered him with teddy bears, you know, and a Bible. And, you know, he was a really good laugh as well. I think people over romanticize things a little too much, over darken things. And I think the film, I think it does it pretty good justice, to be honest. It could have been, think about it, it could have been a lot worse. If you'd said, you know, Rory, whatever it is, McCulkin's brother plays, you know, Euronymous, you'd be going, oh my God, this is a disaster from the word go. But I watched it and I thoroughly enjoyed it. It was good.
Of course, 25 years of putting out Cradle of Filth records. What have you learned about yourself along the way?
What haven't I learned? Tolerance, patience. Explored the world. So yeah, I'm a lot more open than I used to be. I took a couple of our band members around New York today and they were like, how do you know where you're going? I said, well, because I've been here about 100 times. I guess that's it. Just opening your mind to lots of different things, to all kinds of music. And I think that's what's happening with black metal now as well. Originally, when black metal started, in the days of me writing, you know, pen pal with Euronymous and such forth and such like, the bands that were all dominant at that time were, you know, you had like Necromantia that had like three bass players and no guitarists. You had a fledgling Moonspell. You had people like Beherit doing Drawing Down the Moon. It was all keyboard. You know, everything was very weird and experimental. And then it all went very funneled. And, you know, everybody had to be painted up like a badger standing in a midnight forest, you know, looking cult. But now I think it's going back the other way. You mentioned shoegaze. you know, people experimenting with everything because it stagnates. Everything stagnates when it's overdone.
On that note, legends. Check out Cradle of Filth. They'll be on tour in America. Buy all the albums and congratulate them on 25 years of making music.